I'd like to thank our sponsors, Chase, Downtown Dallas, Vila Wood, Touch Titans, Dev Mountain, Circles, Credos, and many, many more. Special thank you to Chase Basecamp for allowing us to use this venue. And if you are sharing any photos or tweets on social media, remember the hashtag is DSW16. And now I'll turn it over to Victoria to go through the special sponsors for the Entrepreneur Shack. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. How are you doing? Well, we want to officially welcome you to the Artpreneurship Track of Dallas Startup Week. We are super, super excited to have you here. And we want to absolutely thank our sponsors, Harada Printing, Firefly, Candy Signature Cocktails, Right Place TV, Karen On Purpose, OL Buckley Companies, and Your Small Biz VA for all that they've done for this session. And also, we would like to introduce our amazing panelists for today that have a plethora of knowledge for you and for your life. We have Miss Dea Direct Smith, James Thomas, Jessica Nunez. Did I say that right? Okay, perfect. And Lady Jade, and more, and without further ado, Dr. Wright. There we go.
Hey everyone, how are you? Good, good. Happy Friday to you. I am Sway Buckley. I'm so excited to have you all here. This is the first year that we're able to offer a track with Dallas Startup Week, specifically for the creative mind. So just in general, whatever that means to you, it's not putting anyone in a box, but just being creative. And this is one of, I would say, a very important session, a panel, when it comes to working and dealing with the media. Especially as a solopreneur, like what exactly does that look like? So we're gonna have, I have a few questions that we already have set up, and then I wanna open up the floor for you all to ask questions. But it's really important to be able to have relationships and good relationships with the media and different people in the media. It's really the people that you're having relationships with, right? And the main purpose of that is to be able to reach the masses with your message, like in one sitting. You know, you can reach thousands, hundreds of thousands of people, if not more, in one setting. So it's all about having that right connection. So that's what we're talking about today. So get your questions ready. I'm really excited to have these amazing ladies here. We have two others coming, but we're gonna go ahead and get started so you all don't miss out on anything. So I'm gonna start over here with Lady Jade, and she's gonna just tell you a little bit about who she is, what she does, and then we're gonna go down, and then I'll go ahead into the questions, okay? Sound good? All right, thank you.
Check, check. Okay. Hi, everybody. How are y'all doing today? Y'all excited to be here? Okay. Yes, I am Lady Jade from K104 radio station here in Dallas. I am on the morning show. The morning show is called Dee Dee in the Morning. So I wake up bright and early every single morning at 3:45, and we just keep on going. We keep on going. But yeah, I'm with K104. I love what I do. I've actually been there. This summer will be 13 years. Wow. And I've been doing mornings for 10 years. So, and I'm originally from Dallas, so it feels great to be at home doing what I love to do. Yeah. So thank you. Thank you for having me. I appreciate it.
Absolutely. Thank you for coming.
I'm Jessica Nunez. I own TruePoint Communications. We're a integrated marketing communications firm. We started 10 years ago this year, actually, so we're celebrating our 10th anniversary. We have 20 employees. We're based in Dallas, but we serve companies all over the U.S., from billionaire clients to billion-dollar companies. We advise them on PR, social media, digital marketing, and grassroots campaign. I started with just me, so, and I've grown it from there.
That's awesome. Thank you. Thank you, Jesse.
I'm Dr. Letitia Wright. I'm host of the Right Place television show. We've been on television since 2000.
They can't hear you right there.
They can't hear me.
There you go.
I've been on television for...
I've been on television for 16 years, and I was nationally syndicated for 2 years on Dish On Demand. And so I started the show from a cable access show to expand it. And the Right Place television show is about entrepreneur and entrepreneurship, so I've had to really learn how to figure out what sponsors are, who to have people on, and all this kind of great stuff. I love interviewing people. I love seeing the light in their eyes when they talk about their thing, and that's what I enjoy about what I do.
Thank you. Thank you. Okay, so now we're going to get to the nitty-gritty. So, ladies, if you can just start off by telling everyone here what you think the role that media plays, whether it be within their personal brand or what type of partnership could someone do with the media on any level? Like, they may be at the beginning of starting their business or have been in it for years. Like, does it make a difference? That type of thing. Can you talk about that?
Absolutely. Well, I'll start as a public relations or publicist. If you're starting out on your own and you're in a specific industry, you know what industry you are in, right? So if you're in beauty or hospitality, you really need to know who's writing about your industry. So it's really important to read who's writing about it. So if you're local and you're just to Dallas, it's important to know who's writing about, you know, if you're a retail store or you have a retail product, who writes about those products? Who writes about fashion in Dallas? And start following them. And then, you know, media love to get feedback, I don't know, positive or negative, I don't know, but they like to know that you're reading what they write, and just don't outreach to them when you need something. It is about building a relationship, not servicing your own agenda. So try to go at it from that standpoint that you want to have a long-term relationship, and you'll really get more out of it.
That's good, thank you. Anything else, ladies?
Just that you gotta remember, in terms of television, it has changed so much. You know, back in the Stone Age, that we had three stations and one TV screen, and now, you know, things are different. There's a screen everywhere in the world. There's a screen on your phone, in your pocket. There's a screen, you know, your tablet. And so think beyond just, you know, when you think about TV, expand your thinking about it, because there are so many different opportunities, so many different channels. Everything is going digital, and people still need quality content. So think about the content that you can bring.
Thank you. So you mentioned content, and then you mentioned knowing who the relationships in the audience, right? So with both of those, I kind of think it kind of ties together with knowing who you are in the marketplace, right? And then knowing exactly who you want to meet or who you want to reach in the marketplace, right? So if I have a pet salon, I probably don't want to reach out to a fashion magazine unless I'm doing something with fashion and pets.
Absolutely. You know, as an entrepreneur, there's only so much time in the day, right? There's only so much you can do. And so you're really good at one thing, and you either need to, you know, find some assistance to help you with those other things, or be very focused on your other efforts. So if marketing is something that you want to spend time on, be focused about it and decide, okay, who does my audience, these people are buying my product, what are they reading? What are they watching on TV? Right. Who's influential to them? Mm-hmm. Let me reach out to them. We had a client once who had a startup, and they were like, do you think you could get these on celebrities? Do you think you could have celebrities, and they're a Dallas-based business, and they're a startup, and they only had so much money? And I said, you know, tomorrow? No, like next month? I don't think that's a good use. Do you really want me to spend our time that way? Like, you only have so much money, and you want Paris Hilton or Kim Kardashian wearing your, you know, your clothes. It's not that easy. I just don't send it to them, and they're like, thanks so much, I'm excited, I'm gonna wear these, and I'm gonna tell the world. That's not how it works. But oftentimes, as entrepreneurs, we're so passionate, and we love what we do so much, we think everybody else is gonna respond the same way. So be focused, build long-term relationships, and try to kind of narrow down what you're trying to accomplish.
Thank you.
And kind of to piggyback on what she's saying about the focus, which is so important. You know, when we are entrepreneurs, we want to reach everybody. Because when we reach everybody, in our minds, we feel like, oh, our business is going to be so much more successful. We're going to make so much more money if I can just get to everybody. Right. But if you do focus down to exactly who you're talking about, believe it or not, like on radio every single morning, we speak to the masses, right? We have all different races, ages that listen to us. But honestly, when we are picking our topics and our subjects, we are speaking to a specific person, one person. We have narrowed down her age, her ethnicity, and everything. And a lot of times it does reach the masses, but it helps you to be more focused. Otherwise, if you're not focused, you're everywhere. And then when you're everywhere, you dilute your brand. You dilute yourself. You dilute who you are. And then I get it. Like, everybody is like, if I could only get one celebrity to get a hold of my product, you know what I mean? Well, work that product and then catch the attention of that celebrity. You get what I'm saying? By narrowing it down.
Right.
You know, that door will be opened up, but you got to know exactly where you're going. So focus was a really good thing.
Right.
Yeah,
and
absolutely.
I agree with her on the focus. Like, really take what she said super serious. When I started Right Place TV show, I knew who would watch this show. I could go into the mall and pick out the woman that would watch the show because I know what she would buy. I call, you know what they would watch. I call that the right rule. Go where the eyeballs already are. What are they watching? What are they listening to? What will they buy? I mean, that what she said, I take that very, very seriously. So if you haven't done that for your perfect client, go home and write up your perfect client. If you're already in business, pattern it after your favorite client that pays up all the time. Not your favorite client that don't pay. That pays up. Okay, so pattern it after that. If you're, it's a big difference. We have clients that we love that can't pay us. That is not your perfect client. We need the client that can pay you. And then if you're new in business and you don't already have a client, you have the freedom of creating this person however you want them to be. But they have to be one person. When she said one person, seriously, you can't go, it's man or woman. No, unless you are selling to hermaphrodites, okay, and I'm a physician, so I can say that. Unless you are selling to hermaphrodites, it is a man or it is a woman. It is not an age range, 25 to 55. Everybody was born except that one dude in the Bible that we can't figure out when he was born. Everybody has a birthday, right? So, like what she said, like totally take that seriously, seriously. Go home and create this person and make them somebody you want to. You know, don't make it somebody you don't like. Make it somebody you like.
And give them a name. We do that for, we have a client. Yeah, we have a client and we have Julia. It's a client that targets a Latina, and she speaks predominantly English, but she has a Latina background, and so they actually named her. You know, we think her name is probably Julia, and this is where she shops, and this is what she does, and this is how she spends time with her family, and these are her hobbies, because that helps you narrow down when you do start becoming successful, and all these people start calling you saying, "Hey, we want you to buy advertising here. We want you to come spend time here." Then you're able to say, "You know what? Julia doesn't go there. Julia doesn't spend her time there," and that helps
you. That's right. I want to do two things. First thing, I want to piggyback off of what you just said. I work with lots of artists and creatives building their brands, and that's one of the main things that we do is go over, I call it their ideal client profile. And so it's like this imaginary person, but it's your ideal client that you really, really want to work with, like in your head. And so we go over those demos, but we also go over the psychographics of that type of person and what they think and how they think. And so if they're not going to go there, then where else would they go? Or what do they think about that place that you may want to try to introduce them to? So really going deeper, it really makes a big difference. Everything that they just said is like so true.
Because Julia, once you get down specific to Julia, guess what? Julia has a friend named LaToya, and Julia's
right.
gonna turn LaToya
right.
on, and then Julia's gonna talk to Becky as
that's
well,
right.
and that's how it spreads, but you're still talking to Julia. So.
Yeah, that's good.
That's really
thank
good.
You. I wanted to introduce the amazing Dia Direct. I thank you so much for being here. Amazing speaker and author and the lead content producer, one of the lead content producers for the Tom Joyner Morning Show. So welcome her to the set. Thank you, thank you, thank you. So just jump on in the conversation. You can share about like what you do and everything that we just said if you have some piggyback on that.
Hi, everybody. Thank you for having me. So beyond what I do for the Tom Joyner Show, one of the things that I do is content in my life also. And so as you may have heard the saying, content is king. So whether it's for your job or for your business, knowing that you're putting out content that people either want or need is going to be critical. You know, because we all have all these ideas, especially as creatives, things that you just want people to have or sell. But you have to ask yourself this, what do I have and offer that people either want or need? And then you have to make it very specific about even timing. When do they want or need it? Why do they want or need it? And why will they want or need what I have to offer? So, the other thing that I do is, as a speaker and as an author, is I put out content every single day on social media, whether you have something to sell or not, so that you're building a relationship with your audience. So that's the other thing that I would say before you just try to sell things to people, like we see with Jade and Dee Dee every day or any other show that you may listen to, you feel a certain way about them. And because you feel a certain way about them and they give you content that you like, they make your day better, they make you laugh or cry, whatever it is, if somebody can help you emote in some way, or you know some, you can make somebody feel something, then they're gonna keep coming back to you to get that thing, right? And when they come back to you to get that thing, at some point, you sell them. But if you're always trying to sell, 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 and you're like, oh, I just put out all this, you know, stuff to just sell to people, well, that's not a relationship. That's just you wanting something from them. But before somebody will ever want to spend money on anything that you have to offer, you have to think about, what am I giving them? What do I have that they need? And basically, you have to basically give a lot of free content in some way or another away before they'll be willing to buy from you. So just keep that in mind and don't get discouraged. You just may want to readjust how you appropriate what you're putting out there. And so the book that I have out now that will that's on pre-sale is called Soft is the New Power. And it's embracing your feminine edge to win in love and life. And so the concept behind that is that even as an entrepreneur or whatever you do, when with your best self, as opposed to trying to do it like somebody else. Like, at this point in my life, I'm not trying to win like a man, because I am, you know, I'm a woman. But the reason, but that sounds funny and like, aha, obviously, but it's not. Because a lot of times we've been taught to try and be in this business in particular and to do it the way others do it. And the truth is, you can only really win when you're authentic. And so, also because of what we've experienced in the past, and we've seen, you know, whether it's women's lib or, you know, not having what we thought we deserved, I feel like we've gone so far to one direction that we haven't found the balance. And so for me now, in anything that I do, even in selling, is soft is the new power, is embracing that, as grandma would say, you get more with honey than you do vinegar. And if you know your audience, for instance, one of the things that I do is the man whisperer panel. Before I could talk to a man or understand a man or have a man in a successful relationship, I had to study. And so we don't apply the things that we know professionally and educationally to our personal lives. But they're all transferable skills if you know how to use it. And so I could go on and on about that, but basically be authentic. Because for the long haul, if you want to be successful, it's gotta be something that feels good to you. If it doesn't feel good to you, it's going to come across, because energy transfers. And there's no beginning or ending, it just transfers. So also in my last note, in any business, give yourself permission to change your mind. Give yourself permission to change your mind. That's in life, that's in love, that's in business. Because when you study, you're gonna find out some things you didn't know, or things are gonna change, or how we used to win is not the way that we're winning. And so be willing to make adjustments according to what you learn, and don't get stuck in, well, this is how I always have done it. If it's not, how's that working out for you, as Dr. Phil would say?
Right, how is that working out for you?
Can I piggyback?
Yes,
go ahead. You're hitting some points. I was like, oh, I gotta piggyback, okay. So, on the being authentic, the pressure of society will have us doing things, like for instance, I work with Dee Dee in the morning. She's another woman. She's super successful. She has paved the way for me, opened up doors for me. But society will have you thinking, well, if I want to be successful like her, I have to do it her way. And so I had to come to the realization for myself that, remember, God gave you your entrepreneur mind. He gave you your vision. Even though it's similar to somebody else's, you have your own lane.
That's good.
And so don't be, if you're into, you know, making social media pages or whatever it is, don't say, well, this is how Mark Zuckerberg did it, so I'm gonna do it just like this. No, because that's already done. So be very authentic to you and figure it out. Don't just copycat. Otherwise, you're gonna live the rest of your life trying to be somebody else, and that is so hard. That is too much pressure on yourself. And then the second thing I wanted to piggyback on, she mentioned social media. Okay. Okay. Social media is so important, but please, if you have social media pages, if you're promoting social media, I tell people all the time, have a personal page and have a business page. A lot of people think that's common sense, but it's not. If a hairstylist contacts me, obviously she's in business for herself. If a personal trainer contacts me, obviously they're in business for themselves. If I have to filter through pictures of you and your kids, or you with your food at the table, or you with, you know, and to you, it seems like no big deal. Make it professional fitting to what you do. See, I can kind of go and do a little bit of everything on my page because my job is to let people into my personal life. That is what I'm hired to do. But if you do something else and it's not about you, make it about your product. I am my product. You get what I'm saying? So there's a little bit of a...
absolutely. Actually, at our company, we help celebrities create their... It's a segment of our business. We help them manage their social media online because that is their brand. The celebrity that you know, you may only know them through social media. You may not have a personal relationship with them. And so if they're trying to position themselves as something, what we do is we call it their brand DNA. So just like Nike has a brand DNA, so does a celebrity. And so, you know, you identify what makes up your brand DNA. Is entrepreneurism part of that? Yes, okay. Is faith a part of that? Okay, let's put that box in there. That means you can post about entrepreneurism and faith-based topics if that resonates with your audience. If politics is not part of who you would, what you would talk about with your customer and your clients, that is never belong in your social media channel. That means when something really bad happens out there and you want to say something so bad, you need to just text it to your husband or your wife, and you need your best girlfriend and tell them what you really think. Just remember that text is always going to be kept, so maybe you need to go to lunch and just, you know, dump on them what you really think. But it does not go on your social media channel because you've established what your brand DNA is, and it's actually odd to people to all of a sudden hear you, and it's off-putting, and you're repelling them instead of bringing them in. Even to the point when you're posting Instagram photos and people only know you visually. I had a brand was going through my Instagram feed the other day, and it's a furniture, very popular furniture company, and they have a store in Mockingbird Station. And I was going through it, and I was like, okay, cool, I like that idea. I was trying to get some ideas for my house. And then all of a sudden, there was cake. And I was like, why is there cake? And then I went, and there was like another living room, and I was like, okay, awesome, okay, back on track. Okay, like that couch, kind of like that table. Okay, next one. And then there was like eggs. And I was like, why is there eggs? I don't need eggs. I don't need cake. I don't want to look at the steak. I don't like the green beans. They had all these kind of, they were thinking that it was home. And so they would like, maybe their girl like is cooking and she likes seeing this. But like, no, I use their Instagram feed to like give me ideas, and then boom, I like that couch. Okay, let me go to your website and check it. Okay, now I'll go to your store, because I don't want to spend my time in your store if I don't like what you already have. So you have to think about how your customer is using social media as part of the purchasing process with you. And every post counts.
And we're not as great as we think we are. Like, we think that we are just, you know, we think so highly of ourselves. So it's like, of course they would want to see a picture with me and my kids. I mean, this was a really cute picture. No, that's not. I'm on Healthy Fit Meals. I want to see the meal and what color it is and how it looks, and you tell me how great it tastes or whatever. So take yourself out of it and think about your audience.
And I also want to say building your social media is really important, because that can help you really connect with people. A couple of times I've wanted to interview like Eric LaSalle. He has a book series out, and I wanted to interview him. And the first thing he was like, well, how many people do you have on Twitter? And I was like, 63,000 followers. He's like, oh, okay. So a lot of you guys want to get to celebrities, you want to get to big names, build your social media so that when they go and check, it's like, oh, well, she's got like, oh, she's talking to somebody, you know. And on the other side, on a personal side, it can get some things done for you. I don't believe in complaining on social media a lot, so I do take this, but I had a problem with DirecTV, and I went on Twitter and said, hey, DirecTV, because the person on the phone was like, well, you got to pay $500, and then you got to do it. It was like crazy, right? When DirecTV and AT&T got together. And I was like, you guys are out of your mind. So got on Twitter, said, hey, DirecTV, I'm having some problems. They look at my account, see 63,000 people, literally got a call from them in 30 minutes, got that problem solved. Didn't have to pay $500. So it works for your personal life, but it definitely works for your business life. So take it seriously and build it.
You had a question?
Absolutely. They're big supporters of you. And that's up to your, you know, your audience. So, you know, I do that on my personal. I use Facebook as a means for both for me, because we have a company Facebook page, but I have a personal profile. I publicize my clients, and I'll say it's a client. I publicize what I'm doing in the community. I publicize what our company's doing. I'm an ambassador for TruePoint. You're an ambassador for your company. So for your mobile app development company. So keep that in mind. It goes back to you being a brand. So if you're posting pictures of you sloshed with a red Solo cup, you know, how does that reflect on your brand and your company? And so, you know, we oftentimes, as you grow, we also, we encourage companies to have social media guidelines, because you maybe been handling your brand, and then you hire maybe a younger staff member or any age staff member. It doesn't really matter. People make mistakes. And they, you know, I always say, don't drink and post. I mean, it sounds like common sense, but don't drink and post. You know, you're going to say something after a couple of drinks that you maybe not would have said otherwise. So, you were personal ambassador.
And unfriend your friends who post you relaxing and drinking. That is not funny at all. I keep my private life very private and off. And not that I'm out sloshed anywhere, but I just have that. We all have that one friend that posts worst picture of you, where you could be taking a nap on the couch, but it looks like you're knocked out. Yeah, unfriend that person, get them out of your feed.
I just got a visual of what you just said. So thank you so much, ladies. And now, gentlemen, Mr. James Thomas, thank you so much for being here. Can you give me a hand clap?
Thank you.
I'm going to let you introduce yourself so you can go ahead and take that floor, and we're just going to keep the conversation going.
Awesome. So glad to be here today. I'm James Thomas. I am the publisher and CEO of Southern Dallas Magazine. The parent company is Power Media Communications. So glad to be here. I love my startup community. That's what this is all about, and I'm just so glad to be able to cover the event and be able to get whatever insights that I can from a male perspective.
There you go.
These women up here.
Have that balance on the stage.
Gotta have some balance, right?
Yeah, so we've been talking about relationships, focus of your market, your target market, and now I want to take that into building a relationship with you all, like the media, with people. What does that look like? And let me say it this way first. How can a person find you all, and then how can they begin to make deposits into a relationship with you?
Sure. A lot of people contact me on Twitter. Media is a great place. At Twitter, we respond very, very quickly. As television media, I'm always looking for new content. I'm looking for new things, not so much to advertise your stuff, but what is the significance of your product to my audience? My audience is entrepreneurs. I had a great pitch from a young lady on the phone, perfect pitch, but it was about a divorce book. I don't cover that. So I told her, I said, you are fabulous. This is a great pitch. I'm just the wrong person, but keep doing what you're doing. And so she was really nice, and she sent me some cake and all that cool stuff. So, of course, I posted her stuff anyway. But, of course, you know, chocolate cake makes it all okay. So you really want to, like I said, develop a relationship. Find out what kind of content, if it's a television, whether it's on the small screen, the tiniest screen, or, you know, the big screen. Find out the content that they're looking for and add to that. Did you hear about this story? Did you know about this? Did you hear about this? A lot of people give me information. I know a lot of things, but I can't be everywhere. And so I appreciate that, and I appreciate, you know, the feedback. Oh, I saw this, and this is it. That's the other thing, is that read, watch, or listen to their show so that you can talk about what you saw. It's okay to say, oh, I saw you and you're on the radio, but what if you start talking about the show that she just did? That was so good, that was so powerful, you really helped somebody. That makes a difference, because people don't do that. You want to be on this person's show, but you've never watched it. When Oprah had a show, I used to say, who wants to be on Oprah? Everybody raised their hand. I said, when's the last time you watched Oprah? Nobody raised their hand. If you've never seen the show, if you never listened to her show, don't go up there and say, I want to be on your show. How many times do you get that, right? I want to be on your show. Don't do that. You haven't even listened to it. You don't even know if you're a good fit. But you can contribute, let her know about stuff, let me know about stuff, and just be a real person. But I'm easily contacted on Twitter. I mean, I'm out there. I'm easily found. Twitter, my phone number is on my Twitter account. I mean, it's like you can call, you can text the office. I am very, very accessible. Okay, we have a mic.
I can be found very easily. We're on Facebook, Instagram, and we're always encouraging people. We like to have conversations. So we may post a question one day on Facebook or something and someone respond back to it. And so we encourage conversations. And one thing I would say though, it's kind of to your point, if you're wanting to get your service and or product out there, you want us to contact you or you want us to maybe feature you in the magazine, don't make it about you. Make it about what it is that you're doing, your service. What's the story behind the story? Because if I understand that, then it's not an advertisement. It's something that's benefiting the community. It's something that's benefiting the readers. Because at the end of the day, it's all about the readers. It's all about the people who are reading and checking us out. If they feel they're being sold something, mm-hmm. then they're going to be turned off with that. And I'm turned off with that, you know? I don't like to feel I'm being sold something. But if you're telling me a story, or say, for instance, I was one lady, she had a book, to your point. But she started talking about the book and why it was important to her. And the personal side behind the book, and I was like, you know what? Some readers of ours probably have that same thing going on. You know what I'm saying? So guess what? We might feature that, and I'm not gonna charge you for that, but if you just come talk to me about, oh, I got this book out, and I want you to talk about it, well, okay, our ad prices are, right. And you can go to Southern Dallas Mag and get the rate card for that, right? But if you tell me the story behind it, if not myself, you know, some of our team members, there's a pretty good likelihood that we may feature you in the magazine or something
so
like
what
that.
So what you're saying, it can be the same situation, mm-hmm. but just different approaches that right. make you respond
Give me something beyond just you're trying to promote yourself.
Right.
Yeah, give me the story. And like I said, we're on Instagram, we're on Facebook. Of course, you can go to our website, which is southerndallasmag.com. And although the name says Southern Dallas Mag, we're much more than just Southern Dallas. So let me just say that. But yeah, give me the story behind the story.
Thank you.
A great way to make it happen.
You know, we've been pitching media for a long time, and I work with them on a regular basis. I recently had a chance to travel with the New York Times an editor, and we went on a trip, and she sat in the car with her on a long drive, and she was telling me, you know, everything. This is what really bothers me, you know, about PR people. And so I said, yes, tell me everything, right? I want to know. And she hit on exactly what you were saying. You know, when they call me and they have basically an ad, and it's something that, you know, they're not thinking about what the writer has a deadline, and they've got stories that they've got to put together, and they've got an editorial calendar, and guess what? They've got a boss too, right? And so you have this whole agenda, but you're not thinking about that, you know, hey, they're not working on that kind of content. Like if it's June, they're not writing about holiday, you know, yet. They might be planning, they might be thinking about it, but you know, you might be like, oh, I've got to get all ready for Christmas. And so I will say, one, be ahead of the game, know what their deadlines are, know what they're working on. You know, call them first and ask them, you know, hey, before I send you something, I just want to know, are you on deadline? When do you shoot? When do you guys film? When do you go to print? Know what they're working on, because you don't want to try to get a story in for the holiday season and it just came to you in November, right? Like that's not going to work because they're already planned out all their holiday content. So be thinking about where they're at, call them up, ask them these questions, or email or Twitter, and just have a good idea of who you're working with and what their deadlines are.
Just kind of to piggyback also, you can reach us via social media is probably the best way. But understand when you do reach us via social media, the first thing we do is click back on your social media page and see how professional you are. Because once again, it gives us the visual of who you are. You know, anybody can sell themselves over the phone, but I want to see, once again, are you, you know, wasted? And, you know, it's like, oh, okay, you know. Because, in other words, we don't want our time to be wasted. We bring you in, and you just printed up some T-shirts, and you're trying to make some money. That's not what we're here for. We're here to help people that really want help. You know, why else would we have these jobs? We're here to assist people because we can speak to hundreds of thousands of people at the same time on your behalf. But don't waste our time by coming in and you're just trying to get rich quick. Another thing that I kind of, that goes along with this is, you know, as you're approaching your business, check your motives. If your motive is really to get rich, this probably isn't for you. You know what I'm saying?
End up bankrupt.
Yeah, because the thing is, if what you're doing is truly your passion, you will do it for free and the money will come. And what you're doing is all you're trying to think of ways to make money. We know it when you walk into that station, into that studio. We know that this is a hustle and that we're just being Don't hustle us. Because if you come in and you're very genuine about your product, guess what? We'll have you back. We'll back you. We'll throw your t-shirt on. We'll take pictures with it. We'll make you look. You get what I'm saying? So, and then come in with some humility. I've had people that have reached out to me on social media before and just something tugged at my heart. And I say, you know what? I'm going to call them. I mean, it doesn't benefit us, but who cares? That's why we have our job. God has blessed us so we can bless other people, okay? So reach back out. Best conversation ever. I was so excited to have this particular person in because their story was amazing. I don't know what happened between our phone conversation and them coming into the station, but they came in with sunglasses on. They came in and they were, you know, answering the question as if they had already made it. This is one radio show. You get what I'm saying? And it really broke my heart because I'm like, wow, the ego in the last 3 or 4 days is crazy. It's okay to go in and not be a superstar. We know that when you're walking in. You know, be teachable, be coachable, let us help you. But just be genuine, be who you are, because people can see that when they look in your eyes. And we want to help people that are genuine. We really, really, truly do, because guess what? Somebody helped us. You know what I mean?
So specifically, you can reach me, probably the easiest way is on Instagram at DEYA Direct. Everything that everybody said. So the only other thing that I'll add is, at the end of the day, it's always about relationship. Mm-hmm. And I use that because when you have an agenda, you know, and I'm kind of scared of you if you don't have an agenda, because you should have a purpose, something you want to achieve in life. But think about it like this. What do you have that I need? How can this relationship be mutual beneficial? You know, if you do have a budget, that's one thing. If it's you need the support in terms of getting more eyes to see what you have to offer, what do you know about my audience or your audience for that matter, where what you're offering would actually benefit? Because we're talking about content in my case. So think about number one, communications 101, and I always start with this. And it sounds simple, but it's so true. And it's kind of been said, but just always remember, know your audience. Then, after you know your audience, then after you determine what you're giving your audience that they want or need, if you want to go to any other entity, then you need to know their audience. What's the relationship between what you're offering and their audience? Is it meeting a need or a want for their audience? That's how you build relationship. And so you want to make, whether it's a reporter or a producer's job, easier. Mm-hmm. Your ability to give me content that is going to be compelling, mm-hmm. and you need to know why it's compelling, not just because it's a good idea, but because of what you understand about who you're talking to, and you know specifically these people need or want X, Y, or Z, mm-hmm. then here's how I'm going to solve that particular audience's problem. Right? So, and their problem doesn't have to be a business thing. It could be a personal thing. So think about it on those terms, and it'll be a game changer.
That's good. Like, for instance, if your favorite station is K104, I hope. But let's just say, for instance, your favorite radio station is K104, but you're opening up a tanning salon, okay? Well, I tan just because I tan, but our audience doesn't tan. So don't just come to us because we're your favorite station.
That's good.
I mean, I can't tell you how many times I've literally had to be like, honestly, you may want, I don't even want to say their name because I know y'all are recording, but you may want to go to the other station, you know, because that is tailored towards that audience. Right. So it all goes back to that one specific person who you're talking to.
That's,
you know,
such a good example. So you all speaking about that now, how can someone just, everything that you all said about that particular type of client, how can they find out what that client is that you work with or pursuing? How, what's a practical way they can know who's your client? Who's your, Jessica, or you were talking about
Julia?
Julia,
okay.
Yeah. How do they know,
yeah,
like, who Julia is? How do they find that out?
Yeah,
versus
so,
just thinking about it? Is there
so
a way?
That, yeah, so for, that's kind of what we do as a public relations and as a marketing firm. We look at, like, oftentimes, I mean, I have to say, y'all talked about Oprah. I was so happy when she retired. I was just so thankful. I mean, I love Oprah. I love Oprah. I love the OWN Network. I love Oprah Magazine. I was thankful because it stopped the influx of people who would come into my office and sit down and say, I want to get on Oprah. Can you get me on Oprah? Okay, I love your whole idea, but you didn't talk about how you're going to get me on Oprah. I mean, it's great. Y'all are doing, you know, I want to check in with you. It's great. We got in, you know, we got Today Show. Great. Love it. It's fine. We got Good Morning Texas. That's awesome. That's great. When are we going to get on Oprah? And it's like, really? Are you serious? Like, do you know who she is? Like, it just doesn't, I don't call her up on speed dial and put her on, you know, like that. And then first of all, it's like you talked about earlier, not your audience isn't necessarily watching Oprah, you know? If your target, you know, she's amazing and we're inspired by her and we love her, obviously, but it doesn't mean that they're gonna see your show that day that you get on that one time. And then, you know, they would get so excited that, you know, finally the call would come and the opportunity would come in and be like, great, we can get you in the credits for $50,000 and you're gonna give, you know, something to everybody in the audience, you know? And so there's those paid opportunities and it's like, okay, how bad do you wanna, you know, be on? And then is that really gonna bring value to you? So as a company, we say, we propel your brand forward. So we use that as a filter for everything. And we say to the client and to our team, when they come up with big ideas or just, you know, a concept, we say, is that gonna propel the brand forward? Is it really gonna move the needle and make a difference? Because if it's not, why are we doing it, right? If we had an extensive budget and we didn't have to worry about anything and we could just kind of have a little bit of play money, then sure, we could go do that. But a lot of clients just don't have that. Even billion-dollar companies, they don't have that extra money just to, hey, go see what you could do. They really want it to move the needle and make a difference and produce tangible results. So you have to look at who is, you know, we talk about that consumer, Julia, what is she watching? What is she listening to? I'm reading this blog. I want to pitch this blog to get this product on there, but is she reading this blog? And have those conversations. Look at their Twitter followers. Click in and see who's following them. See who's engaging with them on Instagram. You know, so you can get a feel. If you can't see the K104 audience member, you can go on their Instagram feed and you can look at who follows them, who comments on them, who likes their pictures, and you can determine, is that my customer? It takes a little bit of research. Get an intern, have somebody help you out. It's a hustle, and you gotta bring all these efforts because you get one shot. You have that one chance to make that relationship, that one impression, image is everything. And if you go to them and you say, hey, I want you to pitch my tanning salon to your audience, and she's like, you know, no, our audience doesn't tan, then is she really gonna wanna even suggest you to another colleague she has at another radio station? Probably not, because you're not doing your research.
I have, when you go to rightplacetv.com, I have on there that this show is for entrepreneurs. I literally tell you. So all of the content is about entrepreneurship. If you look through, my website has, I have owned rightplacetv.com since the year 2000. So you can look at all 4,000 posts. There is nothing about relationship, babies, children. There is, it has expanded a little bit to fashion and makeup and shoes because I got a fashion sponsor. Gwenny B sponsors my clothes. If you go to rightplacetv.com, you can click and get yourself, try it out. It's a, like Rent the Runway for regular size women, 10 and up. And so it has expanded a little bit because of what I was able to bring on as a sponsor. But my guide is entrepreneurship. I'm interested in entrepreneurs. We love our corporate brothers and sisters because they sponsor us and they're amazing, but I just really dig talking to entrepreneurs. It just, that lights me up, and so that's what I'm looking for. So yeah, sometimes people will bring children entrepreneurs to my, you know, if you can tweak it, children entrepreneurs, okay, that would make sense. But that's who my audience is. My audience is the entrepreneur who's moving their business forward. Many times it is a solopreneur, and they're looking for an opportunity for some more education to move themselves forward. I started Right Place TV Show because I was in a place where I needed to learn some information. Right Place TV has been on since 2000. There was no SBA TV. There wasn't anything else. So when I was looking for business advice, and I'm a physician, so there are very few books on how to expand your practice. That wasn't out there. And so that's why I started the show, and that's why I brought the experts on that I brought on, because I brought them to teach, and I'm creating something that's sort of a free educational point. So that's my thing. But it's actually on my site. So a lot of times for TV shows, they say exactly who they're for. It's very clear. It's very out there. Like you said, you just have to do the research. And then look at, if it's a show, look at who their sponsors already are. Who's sponsoring this? Is it Kleenex and Pampers? Does your client need Kleenex and Pampers? Do they have small children? Do they have, you see what I'm saying? I mean, a lot of people have small children, but for entrepreneurs, that's not the first thing on their mind. So I'm not looking for that tribe, okay? And I'm not just a mommypreneur, so I'm not looking for the mommypreneur tribe by themselves. So just watch and just look and observe. But many times for TV shows, honestly, it's right there on the website.
I would definitely have to, for us, you know, you have Time Magazine, you have People Magazine, you have Fortune, and everybody has a different audience. Everybody has different things that's within those magazines, right? So if you do, to your everybody's point, if you do the research and you know who you're contacting and you know what kind of content they have, then you won't waste their time bringing them stuff that they're not gonna use. So I would say, I mean, for instance, if it's an alcohol company that wants me to do something that promotes alcohol, well, you know what? Our audience is family friendly. I'm in like 25 different churches. The pastor will call me on the phone and say, Jane, what are you doing? Why do you have this alcohol company that you're promoting in the church? It just doesn't make any sense. So whatever you're doing, just do the research and make sure that whatever it is that you have that you're trying to promote is akin to what that particular media organization puts forth. So just before you get so quick to call or email or put whatever it is you have in front of them, just make sure you've done your research first and make sure it fits.
Can I ask you guys a question, though? Is there room for people to call and ask? And I say that because you may do your research. It's okay not to have all the answers. I think that's the big fear when you're starting your own thing. It's like, oh, Jesus, if I get this wrong, they're never gonna. So I sometimes appreciate when people hit me up on my inbox or whatever and say, hey, I have a question. Do you guys ever talk about, or would this be something? If not, do you have any suggestions? Again, remain teachable, remain coachable. It's all about approach. You get what I'm saying? So, because it is kind of fearful. Now you guys are going to go home and do all this research and be like, oh my God, I saw a Hispanic person on their page. Are they talking to Spanish people? I have no idea, you know? So it can get confusing. So I think, I don't know how you guys do it, but I appreciate, you know.
Definitely there's someone approached me yesterday and she said, well, I do Reiki and everything and you're a physician and everything. And I said, that's cool. Tweak it to how Reiki could help the entrepreneur. In other words, how can it help you focus? I said, now it's something. But just Reiki in general, and people do make that assumption because I am a physician. They'll go, oh, it's a health topic. Here you go. Well, that's not what I cover on my show. And why is a whole other story. I'll tell you another time.
Just to answer your question, Jay, it can of course call and ask. But again, when you understand the organization well enough, there's some folks you're just not gonna call. If it's a men's gentleman club, they're not gonna call Southern Dallas Magazine and say, you know what if I want to get my gentleman's club out there, James, what would I need to do? I don't know.
Well, what about the people in the strip club? What if they call you and say, I was thinking we could be in your magazine because the people in the strip club, they need Jesus too, right?
They do need Jesus, but all right, that's a different conversation, though. That's a different conversation. Okay, but you're right, though. You're right about that, though, Jay.
On that note,
we're transitioning now.
Are there any questions? We have questions. We're going to go here and then here. Yes, sir.
My goal, I don't do this very well. Okay. My goal, and I believe it's doable, and I believe it's going to happen, is to bring truthfulness back to three industries that are protected by the First Amendment. In three industries that our culture absolutely depends on. One is politics. Two is the religious industry. And then three is the press. And what I don't understand is the delineation between media and press. Mm-hmm. And that what I sense over time is that media is that everybody's selling something. With regards to the press, it's not a selling function, but a telling function. And what I don't understand, I cannot figure this out, is the news being sold?
So I can speak to that. So basically he's asking, is there a difference between news and press? And has, the way I interpret this is the definition of media has changed. The landscape has changed greatly over the years. So he's asking if the media is a subset of the press, or is it on its own? So you really have two different groups, and I really speak one from the FTC. If you really want to get into this, read the FTC regulations on it. It's over 200 pages, but it's what I mean, I'm in the business, and if you're in the business, read it. Because there's guidelines to follow. And at our company, that's one of the things we do, is we help make sure that our clients, as they're working with media, that they understand the difference between what you can do with the Dallas Morning News and what you can do with the blogger who has 500,000 followers. Or maybe shouldn't even have a blog, or he doesn't have a blog, he's on Instagram. It's different based on the outlet that you're working with. But let me talk first about the definition of media and how that's changed. Y'all are media, right? Because you have a media device right here, and citizen journalism is the fastest growing form of media that there is. Because you could be the first person to catch a crime happening on the street, and if you got great footage and it was the actual happening of it, that might be on CNN tonight. So we are all now media, right? And so we all need to look at what we're consuming as far as whatever we're looking, from our tiny device to our laptop to our TV to what the books we're reading. We all need to come to it with this mind of, you know, where are they coming from? What is their background? What is their stance on this? Do I necessarily agree? Is this information accurate? Maybe I want to go to another source to get this. But citizen journalism is a part of it. Then there's you working with a publication like a Dallas Morning News or a New York Times or a Wall Street Journal. They're not going to allow me to take them to lunch and pay for their lunch while I sit down and tell them about my client or bring my client along or they eat at that restaurant. They're not going to do that because ethically, and the school of journalism that they went to, they don't want to have any bias associated with their experience. And they want to be able to say that when I burn you, because I may not agree with everything, I may not like everything your company's doing, that I didn't take a free lunch from you, that I wasn't influenced in any way, I didn't get a free laptop or phone or whatever, I'm going to share my real opinion of what happened. And then you get bloggers and social media influencers who are going to say, you know what, send me everything you got. And some of them are going to say, you know what, to spend my time on this, I'm going to accept a fee for this, and I want your product, and it's going to cost you because I've realized now that I am a business, mm-hmm. and I can market you. And a lot of them, this is where it gets a little murky because you're dealing with a new type of media, you're dealing with, people are figuring it out still. Some of them are gonna say, you know what, I didn't care for your product, I'm not gonna post about it because I see that you're starting out, or I see your XYZ big company, this wasn't for me, but I'm not running that kind of social media platform. I'm running one that I always want to put the best stuff out there, and I want my people to be shopping, clicking, buying, because that benefits my whole atmosphere. And so that's where there's going to be some murky waters there, and you're going to have to kind of, and still traditional media are starting to figure that out too. Mm-hmm. And so you have to start realizing that they're trying to run it, keep a business, and they're trying to understand, okay, hey, if these 10 bloggers over here are doing it this way and they're making a living, maybe we need to be reevaluating the way we're doing it as a business, and you're starting to see those shifts take place. So, you know, come at it with the perspective that this is an evolving landscape, we're an evolving society, we as people are evolving, so we're figuring this out, we're growing. Stay on top of ethically what the law says and that's in the FTC guidelines. And for example, if you're sending something to a blogger, you have the responsibility as a brand to tell them that this is a media comp, this is a sponsor, I need a hashtag somewhere in your post, I need something somewhere that says, I gave this to you to try it, or our company did. And you should write that for them as a little note. We call them in our business editor's notes. Put it in there to tell them, because guess who the FTC is gonna go after when they see that post up there? Not necessarily, the blogger might get a slap, but they're typically gonna go after the company. So it's really important that if you are working in social media and you're working with these people and you give them something for free, that they let people know that that's where they got it from.
That's good, thank you. You had a question? What is a thank you?
I try to say thank you all of the time. For my mentors, what I do a lot of times is when they're speaking, I will come to their events, and some of my friends too, and what I'll do is I will carry their bags, run their table, and set it up. And I'm not there with any of my business cards. Some of you guys know my friend Kim Coles. I do that for her sometimes. And people know.
I want to be friends with you.
Yes.
Can you come with me?
All you guys are my new friends. But here's what happened. I'm happy to do it. I really am happy to do it. I don't mean that in any funny way. What happens is when I did it for my mentor, DC Cordova, I unpacked her. When she got there, I did everything for her like I worked for her. And she said, oh, come and have lunch. She was sitting with all the speakers. Come and have lunch with us. I said, no, I'm manning your table. I didn't have any of my business cards. I'd never introduced myself as Right Place TV with it. I never did any of that. And what that opened the door for was she introduced me to Michael Gerber. He's written this book called The E-Myth. If you haven't gotten that book, get that book. Michael Gerber was so kind. He invited me to his house, okay, his home, to interview him. Okay, I still have that interview on the front page of Right Place TV. You can watch it. I was so giddy, I could barely interview him because I'm like, I'm at his house, and I'm like, you know. But I always get something super, super deep from handling somebody's table for them. So that's one of my ways. It's very different. It's not a thank you card. But if I have a chance to serve in that way, I will do that. And then people are like, well, what are you doing back there? You know, things going bad, you're working for something. yeah, things not going too good, Dr. Wright, you know. But and I could go on and on about every time I've done that, something super big comes out of it. So when I say I will come and man your table, I mean it. Number one, I mean it for my friends. These are my new friends. My friends. And I fly everywhere in the world, so.
That's awesome. Okay.
He wants to be thanked. He's like, I have a table.
Or thank you. I just take him to Starbucks. I mean, you know. But, right, I thank you all. You know what? I'm going to tell you something. There is nothing more important sometimes than something that's handwritten. When you take the time out to handwrite something, a card, a note, or something, because we're all busy, we're all Insta everything, right? But when you stop for a moment and just say, if you just write a card and say, thank you, I really appreciate the time that you've taken out with me. I just want to stop and say, I appreciate you. That goes a long way, believe it or not. So yeah, we can take them out to lunch, we can man tables, and I think we ought to do that, all those types of things. But just taking a moment to just write something, handwrite something. I never forget one of the mentors, he has a book called The $1 Million Mentor, and he wrote something in his book, and he sent it to me. And I still have that book today, because he took the time to write that. I mean, I just cherish it, you know? And so when we can just take the time, stop, slow down, write a note, and say thank you, I think that that can go a long way. Million Dollar Mentors, Ash Davis. Ash Davis.
So I just read a book on gratitude, and it was a reminder that every day we should be saying thank you three times a day, right? Showing gratitude. And I really was reminded that it doesn't start with the person who, you know, is where you want to be, or the big wig. It starts with the people in your life right now, right? It starts with, like, I've got, you know, 20 employees. How am I showing my gratitude to them, right? They're the ones who are building the company. You know, how am I being thankful for them, my husband and my kids, right? They hit a lot of this when mommy's traveling and they don't have me there. How do I show my gratitude and show up in a way that shows my appreciation? So I really try to keep that as a heart of gratitude and servant-hearted leadership. I was interviewing recently, and I wanted somebody in the role who had a servant heart. And I was going through back-to-back interviews, and one girl sat down and she said, "A what?" And I said, "Don't worry about it." It's like, it's okay. And so I explained it to her a little bit. And servant-hearted leadership is where, you know, you put other people first. You show up without your business cards because you don't have an agenda. That your agenda really is, as a leader, to serve them. And so coming at it with a servant heart. And for me, that's how it took me. I didn't start leading my company that way. I came at it, my purpose is to joyfully propel other people forward. My middle name's Joy. I'm a joyful person. I love to have fun. And entrepreneurism made me hard-nosed. It made me, like, you know, it can do that to you at a hard heart. And I went through a period of growing my company where it was just like, you get beat up, you get punched in the face. Yeah. And people don't care. They're not a part of that. They don't know what you have at stake. And when that starts to happen, you can either make a choice that you're gonna be a hard-hearted person, or you're gonna say, that's not what I'm about. Yeah. And that's not who I am. And I made a decision and said, this doesn't matter anymore. These things are gonna have to be not a part of my life and not a part of my company, because they don't reflect who I am. Yeah. And then when I determined that my purpose was to joyfully propel people forward, then I can make all kinds of decisions. Because if it doesn't enable me to do that, then I'm not gonna move forward. So come at it with a heart of gratitude, find out what your purpose is, and then don't just thank people because you have an agenda. Thank the people who are there every day. Yep. You know, I mean, know the people who are help making this happen.
She touched on something very important. Being a servant leader.
Yep.
Is so important. A lot of people in media will disagree with this, but I firmly believe in being humble. Like, I wouldn't have my job if listeners didn't listen every day. So I'm not thinking an artist that comes in there and needs me to promote their album necessarily. I'm thinking that listener, every time I go out to a remote or to a school, you know how I thank them? By having that joy, by giving those hugs, by giving a smile and pushing through my personal feelings to let them know how much I appreciate them. In media, you will never be thanked enough. If you do what you do for a thank you, you are going to be highly disappointed on a daily basis. So you be the thanker. You have the thankful heart. And when you change your perspective, and you say, you know what, people don't appreciate me, but I'm gonna be appreciative, then you start to view everything completely different. You know, for instance, James has a magazine, so his is writing a personal note. You know, everybody has their own thing. But whatever it is that you do, if you're genuine about it, people know. And yes, we do miss, there is a gap in being thankful. But you have to be thankful first if you want people to be thankful to you. You get what I'm saying? So it is tough, because trust me, we all go into jobs every day and we feel unappreciated sometimes. Yes. You work, and you are punched. You're giving, and people, all they do is take. But that's okay, because it's gonna all come back to you. Like, for instance, this bracelet I'm wearing right here. Somebody gave me this bracelet. I mean, this may be a $12 bracelet. It's a low-key bracelet, but they explained it to me. And when they explained it to me, you know, I've had people give me expensive things. And I'm not saying, you know, family, friends, you know, relationships. But this bracelet means more to me than anything. And again, $10-$15 bracelet because of the meaning behind it. The white bead meaning when you're on top, as a drop of water from Mount Everest. When you're on top of the world and life is great, remain humble. And this has a drop of some dirt from the Dead Sea. And it means when you're at your low point, stay hopeful. And these other beads represent everything in between the highs and the lows. I mean, come on. Like, when they gave it to me, I was like, oh my gosh, like, this is so dope. Like, it meant more to me than anything because they meant it when they gave it to me. So every time I look at it, it's a symbol of something. You know what I mean? Every time, I love doing the schools and going and being with the little kids. It means more to me to get a raggedy, scratched letter with a person that doesn't look like me, and they're saying, this is you, Jade. And I'm like, I do not look like that, you know? But the fact that they took their time to do that, you know, and that was genuine. That kid in their heart really thought I looked like a stick figure, you know? And I'm like, you know, but that the genuineness, just be a genuine person, work really, really, really hard, and don't believe that thing that you have to step on people's toes to get where you are. It depends on who's in control. If you want to be in control of your business, you're going to step on toes all day. You're going to fight. You're going to tug. You're going to pull. But when I wake up in the morning and I thank the man upstairs, he's in control. So if I just remain humble, he's got me. Even when the bottom is falling out, he's still got me. So it just depends on your focus. You know what I mean?
That was great.
Fast play.
One of the best ways that I try to say thank you, and a lot of it was covered, is it's very important to me to affirm people. Because what I've learned is that we all want to matter to somebody. And when you see people who are working hard, and you know that they're not, because you understand your own stuff, that gives me a certain compassion for other people. And so when I see the need, I lead. And I think that's a great way to also say thank you. And so it can be as simple for me as saying, I see you today, sister. I see what you're doing, girl, and you are working it. A compliment will give somebody life. A smile is a game changer. And that's a part of soft power, too, is just knowing and literally giving somebody a smile is a way to say thank you. Because, or giving them a compliment, or acknowledging what they did and how good it was, because you're not only speaking to their purpose and affirming them, but you have no idea how you might be adding life to that person. So I always go above and beyond the call of duty, particularly for people who do things for me. And I don't assume they know that I appreciate them. I let them know that I appreciate them in word and in deed, and I always let them know that who you are, regardless of what you do for me, it matters. And if there's, you know, I'm that friend though that always like gives advice even when you don't want it. But in doing that, if I know that I have something or I see something or I can give you something that's going to propel your day or that might give you hope to go on just one more step, then I don't ask for permission for that because I just want to add life to you. You can take it or leave it, but that's my gift to you because of what's inside of me.
Cake is good too, though. I'm not even gonna lie. Cake is good.
Cake is good. Cake is good.
For this amazing panel up here? Yes.
My opinion is social media is very overwhelming. I have Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat all at the same time. You just think so time consuming.
which social media platform should you hone in on?
Kind of what is your favorite? For me, the reason why Twitter's way bigger than everything else is because it was the first one that I got on, and it's my style, it's my favorite. And so find out what you're comfortable with, but also write rule, go where the eyeballs already are. Where's your tribe? Are they mostly on Instagram? Are they mostly on Twitter? Are they mostly on Facebook? Where are they? So be where they are. The other thing is, if you're on overwhelm, check out www.cyfe.com. Cyfe.com is free.
C-Y-F-E?
C as in cat, Y as in you, F as in Frank, E as in Edward. Cyfe.com. It is a free tool that it works a lot like Hootsuite, but it's you can add more things to it. Not only can you add your social media, but you can control all of your email accounts that you have. You can look at stats. It's really super robust and it's free. So I moved stuff off of Hootsuite, and you can schedule posts. I schedule almost all posts. The only live posts that you see from me, no matter how on top they look, are like if I'm actually at an event and you saw me and then you see the pictures, you know I was there and took it. Everything else is scheduled. So, you know, I can live life and not be like on social media. So if you're on overwhelm, start scheduling your posts and add the live things as they come in. Hootsuite is great, but you can only get 3 accounts, and most of you guys have way more than that. So try Cyfe. It takes a minute to set up. It's not going to be instant setup, but everything's in one place, and convenience is king.
Convenience
is key. I like Cyfe. I'm going to check it out myself. For if you're on overwhelm, for us, you know, we're talkers, we're engagers. So the place that lets us do that most is Facebook because of how much you can talk about. So depending upon what it is that you're trying to do, I think is the main question. You know, how are you trying to engage your audience? Where is your audience at? And that's the best way that I can say from a social media standpoint. We're Facebookers, we're Instagram, but definitely Facebook for us because of the type of organization that we are, that works best for us.
I'm actually a big believer of know your audience and go where they are, and then be really good at one thing. You know, so if you can't be on everything, be really good on Facebook. And then I tell our clients oftentimes, because there's going to be a shiny object coming pretty, you know, there's always something else. There's Snapchat, there's Peach, there's Musical.ly now brands are using, so, and audiences, consumers are using, so be good at one thing, and when you are good at that one thing, give yourself that opportunity to then grow into something else. But everybody tries to be on everything, and then they're not very good at anything. Mm-hmm. So,
what do you do? So go where people can hear you and see you.
Musical.ly would be a great place for you to be because are you familiar with the app?
Yeah.
So. Well, then you got to find something that you that you enjoy, because you can't force it.
Right. And if you are annoyed, that's the energy I was talking about. If it annoys you, then you're not gonna put your best stuff out because your energy is gonna be all, I don't like this. And so figure out what you like, and then figure out if what you like likes you back.
Right. Absolutely. Because it does come across if you don't like it, right?
Right. So it's true. Yes, ma'am. One more question. Excuse me. So just to repeat, so you want to say thank you to, if you wanted to say thank you to everyone up here, what platform would you go to is what you're saying?
Well, I'm saying if you want to use Twitter.
Got it.
On Facebook, I don't know if that's right.
So,
got it.
100. So you would do multiple posts. So what I would do is I would try to get a picture, so don't leave early panel. I would try to get a picture with each person. No, the last panel, they all left, and I'm like, oh, I missed them. So I'm kind of giving you guys fair warning. So I would take a picture with each person, hashtag it, and tag them so they can see it, because they may not be following me. They just met me. Everybody except Sway just met me today. So they don't know exactly where my feed is. So what you would do is you have to do more posts on Twitter because you can write less. And you don't want to use 140 characters. You want to make it as short as possible. You want to say what you have to say, but make it as short as possible. So take a lot of pictures, and then you can finish your whole thought. This was great. She had on this. This was great. Sway looked great. Whatever it is you want to say.
Well, the hashtag makes a difference.
Yeah,
the hashtag is sort of the equalizer because it brings everybody back to that one event. And so then you get to see the whole story of what happened. So do we have a hashtag for this?
Yes, we did explain that, share the hashtag. It's DSW16. Mm-hmm. So do that. That brings everybody in the same stream.
But on Twitter, right. No, when I see you put that in your feed, I think that's so cool.
Yeah.
If you tagged a picture of me and him, then I'm thinking, oh, great. Everybody from his magazine now gets to see Dr. Wright.
Right.
You know,
right.
All of her clients that might be checking her out, they might see a picture with me, you know.
Right.
So
or even picking up something that you took away from the event that maybe she said, and then you're adding that picture in, and it's not just, you know, it's kind of showing value, and that might, somebody else might get value out of that, and they might retweet you.
Yeah.
And so then your reach extends even further. But, you know, the nature of Twitter is supposed to be, you know, multiple tweets. It's a micro feed of all of it. Not to like, you know, and even people will blow up your Facebook if they're at an event, and you'll see that, like all these posts. But the nature of Twitter is if you're at an event and you have a hashtag around it, everybody's buzzing around that hashtag. You can search that hashtag and find who else is at that event that you might want to connect with.
Mm-hmm. My friend Mark Micklett says it like this. Shout out to Mark Micklett. He says, Twitter is a conversation in the hallway. Facebook is a conversation in the office. And LinkedIn is a conversation in the business conference room. Does that make sense? Does that help? Okay.
Can you repeat it one more time so they make sure everybody
Twitter,
can hear?
Yes. Twitter is a conversation you have in the hall.
You can hold the mic a little more.
In the hall. You walk past somebody in the hall at work, you have a quick conversation. Hey, you gonna be at the meeting? Yes, I'll be at the meeting. That's it.
So Twitter's hallway.
Hallway conversation.
Got it.
The Facebook is the office conversation. Sit down, have a nice conversation. The LinkedIn conversation is a conference business room conversation. You're not on LinkedIn going, hey, how's the kids? Okay,
right.
You're on LinkedIn taking care of business. Keep it business.
Thank you. We have time for one last question, and I saw you raise your hand, sir.
I mean, that's what I'm saying is that you're all producers of content. It's like you and I were having a conversation.
Yeah.
So you had me. Perfect example. Just wanted to demonstrate that for you. So that's what I was saying earlier is you're all producers of media. It's not just a blogger with 500,000 followers. I mean, things go viral with people who have just a few followers, right? So citizen journalism, that's what I was saying, is the fastest growing form of journalism there is. And we should all have a responsibility for wanting to share accurate, appropriate, you know, information and to be, you know, good stewards of the role we play in sharing media. So, you know, we do look at it like, you know, if I share it with Sway and she's got a following, or Dr. Wright and she's got 65,000 Twitter followers, that whoever she's reaching to, they're very likely producers of media, and they're gonna pick up on that and say, I was inspired by what she shared, I'm gonna cover that too. And that's why social media, I mean, that's why all of these media companies will continue to grow and people will try to figure it out and TV will figure out how to be on your tiny screen and newspapers will continue to reinvent themselves because the way we're consuming media and now the way we're producing media has completely changed. I mean, you could be live. Everybody here right now could share with your feed on Facebook Live. You could click the little button and you could all be recording. You could be on Periscope. And the other day, I went to Austin to the Capitol with my daughter's field trip. And we have family that can't be with us that don't normally, mm-hmm. they don't see us. And so I Facebook Lived our tour through the Capitol. And people were like, wow, that's amazing. We just felt like we were at the Capitol with you. I was a producer of media, and the star of it was my 9-year-old daughter, right? And so that's where we're all at, and that's why we have to be attentive to what we're doing and the kind of content and who we're sharing it with. Now, I didn't put it on my Twitter feed, and I didn't put it on my Instagram, and I didn't talk about that there because I treat those pieces of media different.
And the only other thing, I'm sorry.
I was just gonna say, I agree with you, we're all producers of media.
Absolutely, and so as it relates to Julia, I would engage with Julia so that Julia will continue to engage with me. Right. And just on that note, I think for those of us who are trained professionals in the communications industry, I think there initially when it came to social media, there was a lot of ego and dismissiveness mm-hmm. about bloggers mm-hmm. and so on and so forth. Mm-hmm. And so it was social media is the great equalizer. Yes. And so it's a game changer. And even as it relates to advertisers, they're not necessarily always going to traditional media for the same thing when they can get it from an influencer, right? So Julia matters. And so what I have to do is remain relevant to Julia, but also I also have to learn from Julia. And so that's the relationship. And at all points, and I think really social media forces us to all be humble because a lot of people don't necessarily want to, and that's why I say always give yourself permission to change and grow because it's the game has changed. Mm-hmm. And so if you want to win or be effective or to make a difference or to sell your product, whatever it is, you must adjust accordingly. And yes, it might be outside of your comfort zone, but isn't all growth uncomfortable at mm-hmm. some point? Sure. You know, think about mm-hmm. it.
When I don't to go to the gym.
I don't like it, right? And so, and then when you go to the gym, mm-hmm. whatever muscle you work is the one that's going to be the strongest. Mm-hmm. And if you don't work that muscle, the ones that you don't work, it's gonna be weak. And so if you don't work your social media muscle, then don't be confused as to why you don't have an audience, yep. and Julia does. Because yep. Julia is focused on that muscle. So we have to diversify our portfolio. We have to diversify our media portfolio, just like we have to diversify our financial portfolio, and we have to diversify our ability to communicate and to engage with the audience that we want to be in touch with.
Absolutely.
When I just wanted to speak to that question, too. When I think about your question, I think immediately about what I would do, what happens when everybody is a producer of content. Well, then, at the knowledge level that I'm at, then I become a content platform so that Julia and everybody else can bring their content to me. And that's what you can also do now. You don't have to be a producer of content. You can be an aggregator of content. And there's a place for that. So I don't feel freaked out that everybody has a camera. Everybody can be paparazzi. So everybody, you know, like your mom says, be on your good behavior. Everybody got to be on good behavior because you could be taking a picture of at any time. So that's what's next. Now, if you feel like you don't want to get in the fray in terms of being the content producer, you can aggregate the content. You can be the platform. You can be the place that everybody comes for X content, wherever it is. One of the specialties that I have is crowdfunding, that I'm a place where people come for that kind of content.
Okay. Anybody else? Okay. You're good? Okay, we are out of time. I want to make sure all the panelists got a chance to give their closing remarks. So can we just give them an amazing round of applause? So much for coming out. Thank you. So they're here for as long as they can be here, maybe for a few more minutes if you want to come and ask questions, take pictures. I'm sure they are more than happy to do that with you. Thank you all so much for coming. My goal for just this whole experience, especially for creatives, is just to get all the things that I wish I had when I was starting my businesses. Like, there's so much and so many questions out there, and it's really hard to find people who are willing to give, right? It's really hard to find genuine people that will show you the ropes and give feedback to whatever it is that you're doing. So that's my whole desire for you all, to take away all this great information and meet amazing people, like start relationships, you know, start building. This is an opportunity to have them face to face. Use this opportunity to start building relationships and start making deposits. Okay, so thank you all so much. Have an amazing rest of the day. We have a 4 o'clock session today with Dr. Wright, Creative Financing 101. Yes, Alternative Finances 101. And then tomorrow, Art and Innovation at 11 o'clock. And our last session for this whole entire week is at 4 o'clock, from 4 to 6. It is the Creative Fest. We have an IP attorney coming to speak for a few moments regarding intellectual property and dealing with art and your craft, so you know how to protect that. And then we'll also do another session, very quick, short session on strategic financing, but it's going to be arts and music and dance and drama and food and all that great stuff. So come on out. Okay. Thank you so much. Y'all have a good one.